Profile Audio presents Russia, Myths and Realities, written by Rodric Braithwaite and read by Ciaran Saward.
Author's Note. In writing about Russian history, you are faced by an immediate problem. What do you call the country you are writing about? It has been known as Rus, Muscovy, Russia, the Russian Empire, the Soviet Union, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, the Russian Republic. Not only Russians live in this country. At various times, its inhabitants have included Ukrainians, Poles, Tatars, people from the Baltic, the Caucasus, Central Asia, and many other places. Each name has political and historical overtones about which there is passionate disagreement among scholars, politicians, journalists, and ordinary people. There is a particular problem about how to name the state based on the medieval city of Kiev. Most Russians call it Kievan Rus and believe that their modern state is its direct descendant. That is something that many Ukrainians vehemently deny. They call the city Kiev and insist on the Ukrainian spelling of other proper names too. I have tried to use whichever spelling seemed appropriate to the historical period, but many people will inevitably disagree with me. Part of the book that follows is an attempt to explain why these differences are so important. I apologize for nevertheless finding it simplest to use the words Russia, Russian, and Kiev for much of the time. In transcribing Russian words into English, I have deliberately avoided the standard scholarly systems. I have tried instead to make things as easy as may be for the non-Russian speaker. Russian speakers will be able to work out the original spelling for themselves. The sounds should therefore be spoken as written. Sounds that do not exist in English are represented thus. KH sounds like CH in loch. ZH sounds like GE in rouge. An E at the beginning of a Russian word is usually pronounced Ye, thus Yeltsin, not Eltsin. But Mount Elbrus, not Mount Yelbrus, because in Russian the E in this case is a different letter. While E diaeresis is pronounced yo. Thus, Fedor is pronounced Fyodor, and I so spell it, and similar names such as Semen / Semyon. Khrushchev and Gorbachev are pronounced Khrushchev and Gorbachev, but I have chosen to stay with the more familiar spellings. I use familiar English versions, Moscow, not Moskva, Peter, not Pyotr, Alexander, not Alexander. But I depart from consistency when that feels best. So, for example, I prefer Mikhail to Michael. People unfamiliar with them find Russian names very hard to remember. It's almost impossible to make it easier, but it may help occasionally if you remember that between the first name and the surname in Russian comes the patronymic, which ends in Ovich / Yevich for a man and Ovna / Yevna for a woman. One can't distinguish in English between two men both called John Johnson, but Ivan Ivanovich Ivanov is John Johnson, son of John, and Ivan Stepanovich Ivanov is John Johnson, son of Stephen. It is perfectly proper to refer to someone by his or her first name and patronymic. Thus, the last president of the Soviet Union and the first two presidents of the Russian Republic could be respectfully addressed as Mikhail Sergeyevich, Boris Nikolaevich, and Vladimir Vladimirovich. I have spelled the last syllable of Russian names, where appropriate, as SKY. I have left Polish names ending in SKI, since that is how they are spelled in Polish. This book is too short to support scholarly notes or a bibliography. I have, however, attributed direct quotations in endnotes, and I have added a very short and personal list of books.
Prologue. Nation, myth, history. Russia is a country with an unpredictable past. Popular Russian saying. Everyone has a national narrative, constructed from fact, fact misremembered, and myth. People tell themselves stories about their past to give some meaning to the confusions of their present. They rewrite their stories from generation to generation, to adapt them to new realities. They omit, forget, or wholly reinvent episodes that are uncomfortable or disgraceful. These stories have deep roots,
They feed our patriotism. They help us understand who we are, where we come from, where we belong. Our rulers believe them no less than we do. They hold us together in a nation and inspire us to sacrifice our lives in its name. The British have their island story of undeviating progress from Magna Carta towards power, freedom, and democracy, punctuated by shining victories over the French. Winston Churchill wrote it up in his grandiloquent A History of the English-Speaking Peoples. The English acquired, exploited, and then lost three empires in 600 years. The descendants of their imperial subjects think of them as greedy, brutal, devious, and hypocritical. That is not at all how they think of themselves. But the nation is a slippery thing. Nations are like amoebas. They emerge from the depths of history. They wriggle around. They split by binary fission, recombine in different configurations, absorb their neighbours or are absorbed by them, and then disappear. War, politics, dynastic marriage, popular referendums shift provinces from one side of a frontier to the other. Ordinary people can be born in one country, grow up in another, and die in a third, all without leaving their hometown. Ask a Frenchman who was born in Alsace-Lorraine in 1869. Ask an Austrian Jew who was born on the border of Slovakia and Hungary in 1917. Ask a Pole who was born before the Second World War in what is now the Ukrainian city of Lviv, which since its foundation as Livhorod in the 13th century has been known to its Polish, Austrian, German and Russian rulers as Lvov, Lemberg and Lvov. Few of the states in today's Europe existed before the First World War. When Columbus discovered America, Germany, Italy, Russia, and even France and Britain were still fragmented, and the Polish-Lithuanian Union was on the way to becoming the largest state in Europe. The idea of Europe is itself largely an artificial construction, an attempt to bring under one roof a collection of countries at the western end of the Euro-Asian landmass, each very different from the others, ranging from Iceland to Romania, from Norway to Greece, from Spain to Estonia. Loosely bound together by a tradition of Christianity and a murderous record of domestic persecution, bloody rebellion, and violent religious conflict at home, endless war for power and loot, genocide, slavery, and imperial brutality abroad. By those depressing standards, Russians have as good a claim to be European as anyone else. Partly because of its huge extent eastwards into Asia, both Russians and foreigners nevertheless wonder whether Russia is part of Europe at all. Many of their immediate neighbours consider them Asiatic barbarians and point angrily to the sufferings that the Russians have inflicted on them over the centuries. Napoleon was right, they think, when he allegedly said, "Scratch a Russian and you'll find a Tartar." More than 1,000 years ago, a people arose on the territory of today's Russia whose origins are disputed. They adopted the Orthodox version of Christianity from Byzantium, thus irrevocably distinguishing themselves from those elsewhere in Europe who chose Roman Catholicism. They developed their own Slavonic language. They created Kievan Rus, which for a while was the largest and one of the most sophisticated, if also one of the most ramshackle, states in Europe. It is from here that today's Russians, Ukrainians, and Belarusians trace their origins. But Kievan Rus was invaded and destroyed in the 13th century by the Mongols. Its splintered fragments were reassembled over the following centuries under the name of Muscovy by the hitherto insignificant northern city of Moscow. The new state was struck down by internal strife, economic disaster, and Polish invasion. It recovered, and Peter the Great and his successors transformed it into an imperial great power, a dominant force in European politics. In the 19th century, Russia helped to define the nature of modern European culture. Russia's existence was again seriously challenged by Napoleon, by the Germans, and as a result of the wounds the Russians inflicted on themselves in the 20th century. Stalin put Russia back on the map, transformed the economy, and won the war against Germany, all at a horrendous human cost. Then in 1991, the empire flew apart. Russia collapsed again into poverty, incoherence, and international irrelevance. For many Russians, it was Vladimir Putin whom they elected president in 2000, who saved them from unbearable humiliation and restored Russia to something like its rightful place in the world. Edward Gibbon said that history is little more than the register of the crimes, follies, and misfortunes of mankind. Russians, like the rest of us, prefer to believe that their history has progressed in a straight and positive line. They explain away troubling events, such as the brutal reigns of Ivan the Terrible or Stalin, as necessary stages on the path to greatness. The Russians are fascinating, ingenious, creative, sentimental, warm-hearted, generous, obstinately courageous, endlessly tough, often devious, brutal, and ruthless. Ordinary Russians firmly believe that they are warmer-hearted than others, more loyal to their friends, more willing to sacrifice themselves for the common good, more devoted to the fundamental truths of life. They give the credit to the Russian soul, as broad and all-embracing as the Russian land itself. Their passionate sense of Russia's greatness is paradoxically undermined by an underlying and corrosive pessimism, and it is tempered by resentment that their country is insufficiently understood and respected by foreigners. Russian reality is coloured by the disconcerting and deeply rooted phenomenon of vranyo. This is akin to the Irish blarney, but lacks the overtone of roguish charm. Individuals, officials, governments tell lies if they believe it serves their interests, or those of their bosses, their organisation, or the state. They were doing it in the 16th century, when English traders advised their colleagues to deal with Russians only in writing. For they be subtle people, and do not always speak the truth, and think other men to be like themselves. They're doing it today. They're little concerned if their interlocutor is aware that they are lying, though that does not stop Russian governments from punishing those who challenge their veracity. Ordinary Russians may find it easier to believe what their government says, but there are limits. Disgust with the entangling lie drives many of the characters in Dostoevsky's novels to extravagant confession. The systematic mendacity of Soviet officials and ideologists was a constant theme of dissident writers such as Alexander Solzhenitsyn. As repugnance grew among ordinary people too, it helped to bring down the Soviet regime. Churchill remarked that Russia is a riddle wrapped in a mystery, inside an enigma. That has become an excuse for intellectual laziness. But understanding Russia is a challenge, and you have to start by trying to disentangle the facts from the myths, created both by the Russians themselves and by those who dislike them. The Encyclopedia Britannica described Russia in 1782 as a very large and powerful kingdom of Europe, governed by a complete despotism and inhabited by vicious and drunken savages. The Marquis de Custine, a French reactionary deeply at odds with his own society, visited Russia briefly in 1839. The book he wrote, La Russie en 1839, was highly intelligent, perceptive, witty, biased, and profoundly superficial. He saw little of Russian society apart from the aristocracy, who he concluded had just enough of the gloss of European civilization to be spoiled as savages, but not enough to become cultivated. They were like trained bears who made you long for the wild ones. Custine's book was compulsory reading in the US Embassy in Moscow in the 1960s. It reflects the attitudes of many foreign observers today. It is not the best starting point for any attempt to understand the country. Some argue that there was never anything as coherent as a Russian national state. Most Russians, though, seem to have little doubt. Whatever is meant by a nation, they believe that theirs is exceptional, chosen by God or history to bring enlightenment to a benighted world. This messianic sense of mission was born out of orthodoxy in medieval Muscovy and has survived ever since. It was promoted by Dostoevsky and a host of others in the 19th century. In the 20th century, the Bolsheviks shared the sense of mission, although for them, God was replaced by history, working its way through the instrument of communism. But their brave new world began to look suspiciously like the old Russian Empire, under another name. Russians and those who wish them well can be forgiven for despairing at the disasters they so regularly inflict on others and on themselves. After the Soviet collapse, they returned to the idea that modern Russia had an exclusive claim to the inheritance of the Orthodox state of Kievan Rus. Vladimir Putin was consumed by the idea that our great common misfortune and tragedy was the division since 1991 between Russia and Ukraine, between the parts of what he called essentially the same historical and spiritual space. The obsession fueled his invasion of Ukraine in February 2022. A fascination with Russia and its people has occupied me for much of my life. I was there as the Soviet Union collapsed. That colours some of the judgments that follow in this short and, I hope, measured history. Even before the Berlin Wall came down, it seemed as if Ukraine's desire for independence might trigger the disintegration of the Soviet Union. By the early 1990s, neither a war between Russia and Ukraine, nor the possibility that the Russian democratic experiment would fail as disastrously as Germany's Weimar Republic, seemed beyond imagination. Some of my other judgments were sadly wrong. Russia has not yet lost its imperial itch. Putin's brutal invasion of Ukraine has postponed for many decades the prospect that Russia will become the modern democratic state at peace with its neighbours, which so many courageous Russians had fought so hard to create. But no people should ever be written off as beyond redemption. I hang on to the golden image of the firebird, which flits through the dark forests of Russian folklore to symbolise the hope that Russia will see better days. Chapter 1. Birth of a Nation. Are you Christians, or some sort of Catholics? Elderly Russian village lady, 1991. In 1952, Vladimir's grandmother had him baptised into the Orthodox Christian faith, even though Stalin was still alive, and the Soviet Union was still the first atheist state in history. As president Vladimir Putin, half a century later, that baby regularly attended the great ceremonies of the Russian Orthodox Church. He was reverting to an ancient tradition. The Lesson of Byzantium. More than 1,000 years ago, Russians chose Orthodox Christianity in preference to Catholicism. That choice profoundly affected their history and still dramatizes the differences between Russia and the rest of Christian Europe. When the Soviet Union collapsed, lifelong communists discovered that they had been believers all along. By 2008, nearly three-quarters of adult Russians identified themselves as Orthodox Christians. Whether their faith and that of their president was genuine, whatever that might mean, was not the point. It was a matter not of faith, but of identity. Orthodox Christianity was once more a central factor in Russian life and politics. Orthodox Christianity replaced communism as the professed ideology of the Russian armed forces. In 2020, the armed forces got their own ornate cathedral in Moscow. Orthodox priests routinely sprinkled new missiles with holy water. And in 2022, the Patriarch blessed the soldiers invading Ukraine. Rumour said that Putin had a spiritual confessor, Father Tikhon Shevkunov, the head of the Sretensky Monastery, just up the road from the Lubyanka, the headquarters of the secret police, the KGB, for which Putin once worked. In 2008, Shevkunov produced a television film entitled Fall of an Empire, The Lesson of Byzantium, about the sacking of Byzantium, the capital of Orthodox Christendom, by a motley gang of crusaders in 1204. Only by commandeering Byzantium's material and intellectual riches, claimed Shevkunov, could Catholic Europe become civilized. Shevkunov comes to a forceful conclusion. The vengeful hatred of the West towards Byzantium and its heirs continues to this day. Without understanding this shocking but undoubted fact, we risk not understanding not only the history of long gone days, but also the history of the 20th and even the 21st century. To Western ears, that sounds extreme. For many Russians, it nevertheless reflects an emotional and historical reality. What happened in Byzantium still affects their view of the world. Christianity divided. Christianity was divided from the beginning. Christ's followers soon split between St. Paul, who wanted to carry the gospel to the outside world, and those who believed it should be reserved to the Jews, among whom it was first propounded. Christ's favourite disciple, Peter, was the first bishop of Rome. His successors claimed to be the guardians of the truth he had received from Christ himself, and therefore entitled to act as the spiritual head of all Christians. But the Emperor Constantine the Great transferred his capital from Rome to the Greek city of Byzantium in 324, and renamed it Constantinople after himself. It became the Christian as well as the imperial capital. Its inhabitants had no doubt that theirs was the only truly Orthodox faith. For them, the Roman Church was uncultured and uncivilized. Barbarians almost without writing, altogether illiterate, as one Byzantine historian put it in the 12th century. The split widened. In the name of the same loving God, all sides anathematized, persecuted, and often killed those they considered heretics. All over Christendom, church and state competed for authority. Disputes over doctrine acted as a surrogate for conflicts over power. Byzantine emperors claimed to rule by divine right, so did European kings, such as Charles I of England and Louis XIV of France. The papacy, for centuries a powerful secular state itself, never hesitated to meddle in the affairs of those around it. Those who escaped from the grip of the Pope fell into that of their local monarch. Religious conflict soaked Europe in blood until the late 17th century. But with the Enlightenment, skepticism grew, until by the 20th century, many Europeans believed that religion was a declining force that would eventually disappear. That belief was, to put it mildly, premature. Although that quintessential product of the Enlightenment, the American Constitution, separates church and state, no American politician dares openly disbelieve in God. In 2011, 60% of the British population still called themselves Christian. Militant Islam once again began to play a major part in national and international politics. In Eastern Europe, the Roman Catholic Church helped oppressed peoples preserve their identity under communism. Orthodoxy helped the Russians to survive occupation by the Mongols. The oppressions of the Tsars, the relentless atheistic brainwashing of the Bolsheviks, and Stalin's bloody repression. The Orthodox connection runs like a thread through Russian history. Sometimes the church has been in collusion with the secular power. Sometimes it has been in violent conflict. Sometimes it has been almost lost to sight. But from the 10th century, when Prince Vladimir of Kiev chose to be baptized, to the 21st, when President Putin embraced it for his own purposes, the church has always been present. Byzantium. The Byzantine Empire was the longest lived in history. It lasted for twice as long as the Roman Empire, which preceded it, and much longer than the Ottoman Empire, which replaced it. 1,000 years ago, the city of Rome was 10 times smaller than Constantinople. Its churches could not compete in grandeur with Hagia Sophia. The Roman nobility was still camping in palaces carved out of the imperial ruins. Byzantium was the center of the Christian world for art, for literature and law, for military and diplomatic skill. Byzantium has had a bad press. The word Byzantine conjures up a picture of decadence, duplicity, useless ceremony, and tortuous bureaucracy. The luminaries of the Enlightenment saw Byzantium as the negation of everything they believed in. Voltaire condemned it as a disgrace for the human mind. Edward Gibbon assailed the crooked and malignant Byzantine Greeks for their dead uniformity of abject vices which are neither softened by the weakness of humanity nor animated by the vigour of memorable crimes. One Victorian pundit considered that Byzantium constitutes, without a single exception, the most thoroughly base and despicable form that civilization has yet assumed. Byzantium's institutional arrangements were far from perfect. It never created an orderly principle of succession. Emperors came to power as the result of palace or military intrigue and were confirmed by popular acclamation, then surrounded by a deliberately manufactured but stultifying court procedure designed to enhance their authority and grandeur. But it worked. Byzantium was efficiently run by competent bureaucrats, underpinned by a reliable system of taxation. Its legal system, codified by the Emperor Justinian, remains the basis for most legal systems in the West. It encouraged foreign trade. Its coins became the common international currency. Intelligent diplomacy and well-organized force preserved it from external enemies. Women played a significant role in its politics and even in the settlement of theological disputes. The church drew on the authority of deeply pious and thoughtful men. The Catholic St. Thomas Aquinas claimed to read the writings of the Orthodox St. John of Damascus every day. For 1,000 years, Byzantium was the only stable long-term state in Europe. Until its fall, it stood as a barrier against Persians, Arabs, and Turks who were pressing on Europe's eastern and southern borders. Without that protection, some think among the Orthodox, the Western Europeans would never have been able to develop their own political and economic institutions. Some modern scholars also believe that the explosion of literary creativity in Byzantium in the 11th century did indeed prefigure the Renaissance in the West. The conflict between the two versions of Christianity culminated in the Great Schism of 1054. There were two main issues. The first was a doctrinal dispute about the nature of the Trinity. Roughly speaking, the Orthodox believed in the Holy Spirit who proceeds from the Father. The Romans believed that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son, in Latin, filioque. The mutual hatred generated by these obscurities is hard for an outsider to comprehend. It still divides Orthodox from Catholics. The second issue was political. Both sides deplored the split, but who was to be the supreme authority in a reunified church? The Westerners had no doubt that it should be the Pope of Rome, St. Peter's successor. The Orthodox saw no reason to relinquish authority to a man they were inclined to regard as a heretic. At the beginning of the 13th century, Pope Innocent III called a new crusade, the Fourth. The Venetians financed it, primarily to promote their commercial interests in the eastern Mediterranean. On the way to the Holy Land, the crusaders stopped off in Constantinople, where they hoped to install their own candidate as emperor. The townspeople murdered him instead. In revenge, the disorderly, brutal, and illiterate crusader soldiery stormed the city in April 1204, massacred its inhabitants, desecrated its churches, burned down its great library, and carted off its treasures. Among those who died defending the city were the Danes and Englishmen of the Emperor's Varangian Guard. The victors set up their own Latin empire on the ruins. The Venetians profited even more than they had hoped. Among the loot they took home were the 4 bronze horses which still adorn St. Mark's Basilica. This is the atrocity commemorated by Father Shevkunov in his documentary. In the West, it is barely remembered. Among the Orthodox, it has never been forgotten. The Latin Empire did not long survive. The Byzantines recovered their city in 1261. Their empire lasted for nearly 200 more years thereafter. But it had been fatally weakened in its attempts to defend its diminishing territories against the remorseless depredations of the advancing Turks. By 1365, Byzantium was isolated, except by sea. Its Asiatic suburbs were already in Turkish hands. Some of Byzantium's leaders concluded that they would have to make the ultimate compromise. To get sufficient aid, they would have to accept Western terms for the reunification of Christendom. Others, remembering the Fourth Crusade, believed that even a compromise with the Turks would be preferable if it preserved Greek integrity. Better the Sultan's turban than the Cardinal's hat, as Lucas Notaras, the last great minister of Byzantium, is supposed to have remarked. The great Orthodox monastery of Mount Athos had no doubt, and chose the Sultan. In 1439, the Pope called a council in Florence to debate the issues of doctrine, papal authority, and union. The Byzantine delegation was led by the Emperor and included the frail patriarch Joseph II of Constantinople and the more pliable bishops. It was undisciplined, fractious, and poverty-stricken. Outmaneuvered, with the Turks drawing closer, the delegation agreed to reunification on Roman terms. They were repudiated on their return to Constantinople. One of them, Isidore, the metropolitan of Kiev and all Rus, tried to proclaim the union in the Kremlin. He was imprisoned by the furious Grand Prince, but escaped to Rome, where he converted to Catholicism. The desperate emperor sent one ambassador after another to plead for help from the Pope, from Venice and Genoa, from the monarchs of the West. In his extremity, he and many of his senior advisers finally accepted the demands of the Catholics, gambling that the West would help them and that their people would acquiesce. The gamble failed on both counts. The clergy and people of Byzantium continued to reject any compromise with Rome. The Pope and Venice offered mere promises. France, England, and Spain were silent. Genoa did send a tiny but invaluable contingent of 700 mercenaries under an experienced commander, Giovanni Giustiniani. Mehmet II, the young Ottoman sultan, only 21 years old, began his siege in April 1453. There were 50,000 or fewer people inside the city. Apart from Giustiniani and his men, fewer than 7,000 of them were capable of bearing arms, and most of them were untrained. This small band had to defend the city's 14 miles of wall against an Ottoman army of more than 80,000. After 40 days of bombardment, the end came on the night of the 29th of May, 1453, as the people of the city interceded with their god in the great church of Hagia Sophia. Greeks and Italians, Orthodox and Catholic, supporters of union and its bitterest opponents, all prayed together without regard for the niceties of doctrine. The first attacks were repulsed, but when Giustiniani was wounded and word got out that the Turks were over the walls, many of the defenders abandoned their positions to protect their families. The emperor plunged into the thick of the fighting. He was never seen again. The Sultan had promised his soldiers 3 days of plunder. When he arrived to survey his conquest, he found it in ruins. He is said to have been moved to tears. He did not change its name. The city continued to be called Constantinople until Turkish nationalists renamed it in 1925. Ironically, they gave it the name by which it had been colloquially known to the defeated Greeks. Istipolin, into the city, Istanbul. The West showed few pangs of conscience. They took the convenient view that Constantinople had been divinely punished for its failure to accept the authority of the Pope and the doctrines of the Roman Church. "The worse the Latins behaved," commented the historian Dermot McCulloch, "the more they peddled the notion that the Byzantines were devious, effeminate, and corrupt, and really deserved any unpleasantness that was done to them." That view still underlies Western prejudices about the Orthodox Church. For the Orthodox world, including the Russians, the fall of Byzantium was a lasting tragedy. But for the Russians, the tragedy was also a historic opportunity. They now commanded the only Orthodox state of any substance. Kievan Rus. The Byzantine Empire had already lived out nearly more than half its life when a new people emerged to found what became its eventual successor. Sometime in the 8th century, the evidence is sparse and historians disagree on what it means, Vikings, or Varangians, from Sweden began to establish themselves in what is now northwest Russia, a land hitherto inhabited by Finns. They were called, or called themselves, the Rus, a name said to be derived from an Old Norse word for the men who row. They set themselves up in a trading post called Staraya Ladoga, which is securely dated by dendrochronology to 753. According to the chronicles, their legendary leader, Ryurik, went on to found what became the northern city of Novgorod. About the same time, people called Slavs, small groups of raiders who had been a thorn in the flesh of Byzantium, began to move north into the same area. An early Russian chronicle says that these people so despaired of their ability to manage their own affairs that they invited the Varangians to help them restore order. Our land is large and rich, but there is no order in it. The phrase does not appear in the chronicle until well over 2 centuries after the event. Many Russians regard it as an undocumented and irritating slur on their ability to look after themselves. That does not stop them quoting it whenever Russian affairs take a lurch for the worse. Whatever the truth, the Slavs increasingly began to call themselves Rus. The Varangians began to adopt the language of the Slavs, and it is from those times that Russians date their history. But these diverse peoples did not become one tribe, as Catherine the Great was later to claim. Their ethnic diversity lay at the origin of that differentiation between Russians, Ukrainians, and Belarusians, which marked their affairs right up to the 21st century. The Varangians were not content to remain cooped up in the north. They moved on down the great Russian rivers, the Volga, the Don, and the Dnieper, to trade fur, wax, honey, and slaves for fine fabrics, jewellery, glass, wine, and olive oil. The Dnieper, which led directly to the Black Sea, was barred in places by impassable rapids. The Varangians circumvented them to settle on the lower reaches of the river. There, Ryurik is supposed to have established the trading post that by the 9th century had become Kiev, or Kiev, as Ukrainians call it, the capital of an increasingly extensive but loosely ordered state. By 860, Kiev's predatory rulers were sufficiently sure of themselves to mount a raid on Constantinople itself. The city was saved by the intervention of the Mother of God. From then on, Constantinople set out to develop a solid relationship with the new power to the north. The two signed agreements on trade and military assistance, though periods of cooperation were still interspersed with bouts of armed hostility. The Rus become Christian. At the end of the 10th century, the Rus adopted Christianity, an event, one enthusiastic scholar maintains, comparable to the rise of Islam or the discovery of America. Around the beginning of the 10th century, Olga, probably from Pskov in northern Rus, married Igor, the son or grandson of Ryurik. The facts are typically obscure. When Igor was killed in 945 in a minor skirmish, Olga obliterated the perpetrators in an ingeniously brutal campaign and took over as regent for her young son, Sviatoslav. She was an effective reformer and successfully defended Kiev against the perpetual plague of nomadic raiders from the eastern steppes. Christianity was also spreading northwards. There was a church in Kiev when Igor died, and some of his warriors were Christian, though he himself remained a pagan. Sometime in the 950s, Olga visited Constantinople and was baptized into the Byzantine Church. 6 centuries after her death in 969, the Orthodox Church proclaimed Olga a saint, equal to the apostles, one of only 5 women so honored. Her son Sviatoslav remained a determined pagan. He destroyed Olga's new churches and re-erected the pagan shrines. He was a formidable warrior. But when he attempted to conquer Bulgaria from the Byzantines, he was defeated and treacherously murdered by his nomadic allies. His son Yaropolk ruled for 8 years and was killed in his turn by his illegitimate brother Vladimir, who had been running Novgorod on behalf of his father. Vladimir was one of Kiev's greatest rulers. It was he who adopted Christianity as Kiev's state religion, perhaps in 988. Once again, the date is uncertain. The chronicles say that in his search for a suitable religion, he rejected Islam because it prohibited alcohol, and Judaism because the Jews had been abandoned by God after losing Jerusalem. But his envoys told him that the rituals in Constantinople were so impressive that it seemed as if God himself dwelled among the people. So he adopted Orthodox Christianity, as his grandmother had before him. Thus the legend. It is more likely that his motives were political. He may have concluded, as other contemporary rulers were doing, that the imposition of a single religion on his heterogeneous subjects would help to unify and discipline them. The Byzantine Empire was by far the most powerful and sophisticated power in his neighbourhood. An alliance with Byzantium made more geographical, commercial, and military sense than an alliance with Catholics or Muslims. It also made sense for the Byzantines. The Emperor Basil was so anxious to turn Kiev into an ally against his other foreign enemies that he offered Vladimir his sister Anna in marriage, something no emperor had ever before conceded to a foreigner. In return, Vladimir converted to Christianity and supplied 6,000 soldiers to help Basil suppress a rebellion. The soldiers remained as an important and well-paid component of the Byzantine army. Some served in the emperor's Varangian Guard, which later recruited Englishmen exiled after the Norman conquest. This reliance on mercenaries fueled Western contempt for Greek military capacity. Edward Gibbon is noisy on the subject. According to the Chronicle, Vladimir was baptized in 988 in Kherson in Crimea, a colony of the Greeks in ancient times. On his return to Kiev, he ordered his subjects to follow suit. The people of Kiev accepted with reasonable grace. In the north, the people of Novgorod had to be converted by force. Vladimir added a ring of defensive fortifications around Kiev to keep out the nomads. He built the first stone church there, the Church of the Tithe. He founded a library, imported teachers from Byzantium to promote literacy, minted gold and silver coins, set up charitable projects, and encouraged the spread of literacy. He thus created one of the largest and most sophisticated European states of the day. Known as a fornicator immensus et crudelis, with many wives and many concubines, he was nevertheless later sanctified by the Orthodox Church. Ukrainians called him Volodymyr and claimed him for their own. Kievan Rus was not a coherent state, but a collection of princely domains, bound by loyalty to the Grand Prince of Kiev, who kept it together by appointing his sons, each accompanied by a small military force, a personal druzhina, to represent him in towns across the country. These princelings enforced the law, collected tribute from the locals, defended them from raiders, and ensured that they accepted Christianity from the churchmen serving in the princely entourage. There were princedoms in Smolensk, Rostov, and Polotsk in the north, and Chernigov, Pereyaslavl, and Vladimir Volnia in the south, all still flourishing today. Novgorod was in a special position. A trading post even before Kiev, it was the northern anchor of the route through Kiev to Constantinople. It traded busily with the members of the Hanseatic League along the Baltic coast. It acted as a funnel for the lucrative fur trade from the forests and territories to its north and east, over which it exercised a loose control that made it nominally one of the largest states in medieval Europe. The illuminating hoard of business and personal correspondence written on birch bark and preserved in Novgorod's clay soil is almost the only exception to the lack of anything in the medieval Russian historical record to match the copious records of everyday life elsewhere in Europe. In the 12th century, Novgorod still had a prince from the Rurik dynasty, but he had to negotiate the terms of his tenure with the merchants who effectively ran the city. He had no right to raise taxes. Instead, he received a gift for performing his duties. The city's popular assembly, the Vietche, elected its mayor, the Posadnik, and chose its own archbishop, subject to confirmation by the church. This comparative independence was brutally terminated in the 15th century by the increasingly powerful rulers of Muscovy, who had come to see it as a provocation. Kiev's ramshackle political system had an obvious flaw. Its rulers never managed to produce an orderly and durable system of succession, despite intermittent attempts to establish agreed rules. Its history was punctuated by coups, assassinations, and fratricidal warfare. Each princeling could hope that, if he played his cards right, he might end up as Grand Prince of Kiev. The greater landlords, collectively known as boyars, resembled the feudal lords of kingdoms further to the west. They, too, derived their power from land and the people who lived on it. Until Peter the Great more or less settled the matter, much of Russia's domestic history is about the determination of successive rulers to assert their authority over the boyars, whose support and advice they could nevertheless hardly do without. Vladimir's death in 1015 was followed by a murderous struggle between his numerous sons. Two of the casualties were Boris, who may have been favoured by Vladimir to replace him, and his younger brother Gleb. The story is that they refused to join in the fratricidal bloodletting and were murdered by their elder brother Sviatopolk, the Accursed. Both were canonized as martyrs, the first in a long line of Russian Orthodox saints. But it was Yaroslav, another brother of Sviatopolk, who emerged victorious from the bloodbath. Yaroslav too had served as prince in Novgorod in the north and founded a city on the Volga, which he named after himself. His wife was from Sweden, and he was perhaps the last of the Rus princes who retained a sense of the relationship with Scandinavia. Yaroslav proved a worthy successor to Vladimir. He campaigned successfully against the nomads. He married his son to a Byzantine princess. He promulgated Kiev's first code of law, the Ruskaya Pravda. He built the magnificent cathedral in Kiev, named after Hagia Sophia in Constantinople. His son founded Kiev's Monastery of the Caves, which became a center of Orthodox.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.